armor was sometimes called a beautiful costume to die in, because of course if you were on the losing side, yes, you would be fighting. But in some battles, the samurai were more commanding their foot soldiers than they were actually doing a lot of fighting. So getting on towards the Edo period, so we're talking about the 1600s. What happened was Tokugawa Ieyasu decided he was basically going to unify the country. Now, before him, Nobunaga attempted this, but the Tokugawa regime basically was a set of daimyo all from the Tokugawa family who ruled from 1603 to 1868, which is when they formally renounced power. Okay? This period was a time of relative peace. After the Battle of Sekigahara, which was the battle that determined this, we came upon a time of peace. So now you had a bunch of people who were all trained in combat since they were 3 years old, not fighting anybody. That doesn't seem like a very good recipe for peace. It doesn't seem like a very good recipe for keeping the samurai class the way that it had been over the last 600 years. So over time in the Edo period, you had samurai who were, they were trained, but they became more and more and more retainers for their lords. You had a number of samurai who became ronin. They were masterless samurai. And then by the time you got to the Meiji period in 1868, you had a lot of samurai who really didn't do anything other than sit around, eat food, drink, maybe compose poetry, and maybe go see some plays. That was pretty much it. So starting in the Tokugawa period, because Tokugawa did not want to see any further unrest on the part of their subjects, they basically decided, well, we're going to beggar the other nobles. We're going to make it impossible for them to start trouble, because if they don't have money, then they can't pay people to fight battles, because the samurai didn't expect to be paid. Japan was starting to run out of thieves that could be given to the samurai as awards. And so over time, the idea was, the Tokugawa idea was that he moved the capital to Edo. He was an Eastern Japan guy. So he had been in Edo, he moved the capital to Edo. Edo is now Tokyo, okay? From Tokyo to Kyoto, it's about a couple hours, about 3-4 hours by a bullet train, okay? So Edo was a relatively undeveloped town. We think of Tokyo these days as this like crazy metropolis. I mean, by the height of the Edo period, Edo was the most populous city in the world. Edo was huge. But at the time that Tokugawa decided to name it as the capital, Edo was pretty much a fishing village. There really wasn't much there. He demanded that all of the nobles under him would make a progress to and from Edo, that they had to keep their primary wife and their firstborn son in Edo, essentially as a hostage, and that they had to travel back and forth from Edo, from their home fief. And so these people got used to traveling. What eventually happened was the nobles became poorer and poorer and poorer and poorer, because they had to be able to afford to bring their whole households from their home fief to Edo and then back again. You couldn't just throw a nobleman on a horse and say, okay, go. You know, here's a daimyo, he's on a horse, maybe he's got another guy. No, you didn't do things that way. You had your whole entourage. And so there are many Hyōe and other kind of prints that show that progress, this grand parade of all of these daimyo and their retainers going to and from Edo. which is in western Japan. Basically, there was a bunch of Christian enclaves that had been started by Dutch traders. And the Tokugawa family viewed Christianity as something that was a major threat to the way of life in Japan. And so the third Tokugawa shogun basically decided, we're done. We're going to close off the country to everybody. So that was one of the few major battles that happened during the period. So you had Japan, which was this closed off country. You had a bunch of samurai who were kind of not doing a whole lot anymore. You had poor nobles. You had nobles who were raising taxes on their subjects to try to afford this progress back and forth. This was basically a recipe for societal change. So by the time you got to 1853, with Commodore Perry, knock knock, traitor to colonized, the country was basically thrown for a loop. They were up against these weird Americans, where did they come from, who had these fantastic ships manned by a ton of men, amazing weaponry, and Japan had fallen behind in its weaponry and in its battle tactics. Japan, the nobles of the time realized that they didn't stand a chance. So when Perry came back, that is when the Tokugawa period ended, and that is when the samurai class was formally dissolved. So these days, the legacy of these samurai, in a lot of ways, survives. It survives in a lot of different arts and disciplines, everything from archery to kendo to poetry that was composed by samurai, even, or by
car companies.